Thank you very much, Maciej, for the presentation. Thank you for being here. This, as most DH projects, is a team effort, so the presentation will also focus on the team and, as we said in the title, on the capacities. And it's also an international project. It's a project between the Berlin-Brandenburg Academy of Sciences and Humanities and the Oficina del Historiador de la Ciudad de La Habana, Cuba's biggest cultural heritage organization. And since it is of that character, we'll be presenting as a group of three, and we will be presenting both in English and in Spanish. So in a couple of minutes, my colleague Grisel will take over in Spanish, and Antonio will be translating Grisel's parts back to English. This, as our title says, is more about capacities than about the content of our project. So I will not be talking about Alexander von Humboldt, which I usually do at conferences, because that's the area of study that I work in. And I will also not go into details about digital editions or digital repositories. We will try to focus on capacity building. We would show you what we've done so far. The project is in its last year. We started in 2019. Summer of 2019 will be ending at the end of this year. We'll talk about the people who work in it, what we've learned, the institutional change that has occurred through the project, both in Havana and in Berlin, and perhaps leave you with some suggestions on what we think we take out of this at the end. So there are basically two ways of talking about the outputs of our project. One is the more classical academic output. We've created a digital edition based on XIST database and the TI publisher, so also generic solutions, as we saw in the first presentation. We created a digital repository with digitized objects, documents, manuscripts, books, exclusively from, and for the first time from Cuban archives. Five different archives and libraries in Havana. We created manuals, which we published both on our academy's repository and on Senodo, on the ways we've been doing this, on our decision-making during that process. And we, of course, published the data, both the data of our digital scholarly edition work, which is still ongoing, and, of course, on the research software development components that we've been creating in the project. So this is the academic output, and we have a second dimension, which is at least as important as the first one, which is training and outreach. We have a science blog, we have some social web activities on YouTube and still on Twitter. We created an exhibition in Havana in 2022. It's a permanent exhibition, which is part, it's a small exhibition, but it's part of the only worldwide permanent museum on Alexander von Humboldt, which is, I think, quite an interesting footnote. The one place in the world where you have a museum on Alexander von Humboldt is not Berlin, it's not Potsdam or Mexico City, it's Havana in Cuba. And in that place, Casa Museo Alejandro de Humboldt in the old town of Havana, we were given a room to present our project. Which you can visit there if you go to Havana. We've done and keep doing workshops, both inside the team constantly and as outreach training in Havana to gather and sort of combine more people and bring more people together on the stuff we do. And we had a conference last year, and we will have one this year to sum up the project, focusing very much on community building, especially in the Cuban and Ibero-American context. Pretty much all of the people you see here on screen are also here in this room today, so you can engage with them afterwards if you want to. This is our team, both from Berlin or Berlin-based and Havana-based. And as I said before, the main focus of this project is to create capacities, is to teach all members of the team, the content of our project. The idea is to foster with Proyecto Humboldt Digital the strengthening of digital humanities capacities and capabilities in Havana. But as we all know, this is not a project that goes one way. It's not a capacity building that goes one way. It's something that we always do as a team, because at least from my experience, nobody starts with knowing everything about digital editions or digital repositories and then teaches this to somebody else. It's always an ongoing project where all of us learn. So I just talked about the first level of capacity building, which is on an individual level, and now we want to highlight capacity building on an organizational level, which of course in the ideal case is sort of the follow-up development after you get a group of people together which take on the mission to learn together in a DH environment. There's also a third dimension, which is environment capacity building, or capacity building based on environment and conditions which are necessary to do that, which of course in the Cuban, German, Global North, Global South context has quite some dimensions to it. We decided not to go into this, not because we don't want to talk about it, but just because of time restrictions reasons. So, but we do have some slides also prepared for that. If you want to engage on that third level in the discussion, we are very happy to talk about it. This is something that I already said. I just want to highlight that the ways we've been learning, of course, during COVID had to rely on online capacity building. But I would say the two most important things we take away from the reflection on how we want to learn together is that documentation is absolutely crucial, especially in the international context. But in the end, and COVID underlines this, the most important thing is to actually meet up and to spend the money to be in one place for a longer period of time. There's nothing that can be better than that way of learning. So I will give the floor to Grisel and Antonio to talk about the institutional change that this project has caused in Havana.
Bueno, en La Habana, antes de comenzar a hablar cuáles son estos cambios y estas transformaciones en el terreno de La Habana, es importante hacer un poco y aclarar un poco cuál es el contexto en el que tienen lugar estos cambios. Estamos en un evento donde digamos que notamos que el mundo va en un camino bien avanzado y quizás nosotros en apariencia estamos apenas dando los primeros pasos para iniciar ese gran camino. Cuba es un país en América, un país del sur global, y por lo tanto padece todas las características que tienen este tipo de países. Entonces, en un escenario como ese, lograr la transformación digital tiene unas características y unas peculiaridades específicas. Digamos que si tenemos que resumir estos cambios que han tenido lugar en la oficina del historiador, lo concentraríamos en estos cinco puntos: un cambio en la propia organización, en la propia estructura, en los recursos humanos, justamente porque se trata de un proyecto de creación de capacidades, cambios relacionados con la tecnología, cambios también en cuanto al manejo y a la gestión de los datos y, por supuesto, en temas de comunicación. La Oficina del Historiador de la Ciudad de La Habana es una organización fundada en el año 1938.
Okay, so first of all, we need to remark that the context where the change happened, we are talking about Cuba mainly now, and we realize here in this conference that we do belong to the Global South, and that means lack of resources and barriers to internet and many other problems. We need to also realize that the Oficina was founded in 1938, so it's a very old institution. That means that it takes a lot of effort to make changes, but in any case, we can highlight five changes: organizational change, human resources, technology, data standardization, and communication.
El primero de estos cambios que ocurre en el entorno propiamente de la organización está relacionado, o lo focalizamos en tres hitos. Uno de ellos es la creación de un departamento de transformación digital que no existía antes del proyecto Humboldt y que, bueno, ha sido creado con el objetivo de transformar digitalmente toda la institución y sobre todo los asuntos relacionados con el patrimonio. Este grupo tiene tres grandes áreas: un área de gestión de datos, otra área de desarrollo de software y otra más enfocada a la digitalización de los objetos patrimoniales. Otro cambio importante ha tenido que ver con las relaciones entre el patrimonio cultural, o sea, la parte, digamos, más humanista y humanística de la gestión de la Oficina del Historiador y las tecnologías, el área de las tecnologías focalizadas en la dirección de informática y comunicaciones. O sea, se ha tratado de un proyecto que nos ha enseñado a trabajar de manera transdisciplinar y no cada uno por su lado como sucedía hasta el momento en que llegó Humboldt a La Habana. Bueno, el proyecto Humboldt a La Habana. Y otros cambios, por supuesto, están relacionados con el cambio de mentalidad. Yo diría que es el cambio más importante, el más difícil de lograr. Y bueno, hemos logrado cambios, por supuesto, cambios que si lo tuviéramos que medir estarían en diferentes niveles, en diferentes momentos, porque depende de las posiciones, depende de los conocimientos, etcétera, en este cambio de mentalidad. Es una institución, repito, muy antigua, una institución que viene de un mundo totalmente analógico y bueno, el cambio ha sido realmente fuerte. Sobre todo en cuanto a el trabajo con acceso abierto, con acceso a los datos, este ha sido uno de los cambios más importantes.
So at our organizational level, the first change is the creation of the new department, Digital Transformation. This department is in charge of three main areas and the collections of the institution, and it has a very big role and function in the institution. The three main areas are data management, research software, and digitization. But we can also talk about a second change. This lies in the relationship between the two main departments, the cultural heritage collections and IT department. Now we are working in a more transdisciplinary way, and our relationship is stronger and more frequent. Finally, we can highlight a third change at this level, is our mindset has changed a lot. We used to work more traditionally and analogic, but also more disciplinary. And now we work in a team and in collaboration with IT in a horizontal way. We must also mention that we have learned a lot about open access and open data, and that has been also a big change of mind.
El otro cambio tiene relación total con los recursos humanos en dos sentidos, fundamentalmente. Uno, en crear justamente este grupo de transformación digital que, digamos, va a la cabeza de todo este proceso. Estamos hablando de una institución extremadamente grande, con miles de trabajadores, y, por supuesto, todos los recursos humanos no se capacitan ni de la misma manera ni a la misma vez. Por eso es que hacemos tanto énfasis en la importancia de esta área de transformación digital, que es el que va alando, es la locomotora que va alando el resto del tren de la institución. Y bueno, por supuesto, se ha focalizado mucho este trabajo con los recursos humanos en la formación de capacidades. Bueno, y el proyecto Humboldt Digital ha sido una plataforma para esto. Uy.
So, human resources. We have to find and recruit new team members and build their digital capacities from a transdisciplinary point of view, and that was also a big challenge.
Otro cambio sustancial ha sido en el entorno tecnológico. Nosotros, la institución, la Oficina del Historiador, ha tenido muchos proyectos de cooperación internacional donde la tecnología ha tenido un peso importante. La tecnología, sobre todo, vista hasta este momento en cuanto a la adquisición de tecnologías, en cuanto a la adquisición de equipamiento. Y aunque el proyecto Humboldt Digital también ha tenido de eso, ha focalizado sobre todo el desarrollo de las tecnologías en la creación de una infraestructura dentro de la Oficina del Historiador que nos permita, cuando el proyecto Humboldt termine, pues poder seguir adelante proyectos Humanidades Digitales. Ahí hay una gran fortaleza y un gran cambio donde se han creado este ecosistema que estamos presentando relacionados con el tratamiento de imagen a través de IIIF. Hemos creado la infraestructura para poder editar digitalmente estos documentos relacionados con Humboldt y otros que en el futuro ya estamos pensando editar. Estamos también creando una infraestructura para poner al servicio del público todo ese patrimonio que hasta hace muy poco estaba exclusivamente en los museos, las bibliotecas y los archivos, y creemos que, bueno, este es uno de los cambios más radicales que ha habido en cuanto al proyecto.
Technology. We have acquired new equipment, but above all, we have built software infrastructure that complements our processes, and which until now was non-existent in Cuba and in our institution. For example, we have installed IIIF for image publishing and processing, TI Publisher for digital editions, Omeka and DSpace for digital objects, etc.
Otro cambio, también de los más trascendentales, ha estado relacionado con la estandarización de los datos. Repito que es una institución antigua, una institución totalmente que emerge del mundo analógico, con una gran gestión presencial, física, asociada al patrimonio, pero muy poca gestión digital. El trabajo aquí se ha focalizado mucho en tratar de llegar a tener toda esa información generada a través de investigaciones, a través de los años, en datos que efectivamente sean comprensibles por máquina, interoperables, estandarizados, etcétera. Y para eso hemos usado una plataforma tan simple como Excel para lograr llevar a esa tabla de Excel todos estos datos que están mapeados con estándares internacionales, y bueno, eso es lo que se importa paulatinamente sobre todo a uno de los repositorios.
Okay, so on data standardization, again remember that we are talking about an old institution with many museums, libraries and archives which have worked in isolation in terms of methodologies, and thanks to the project we have learned to achieve a first degree of standardization for structured data, metadata. We start with an Excel and then we map to different schemes and different standards.
Bueno, el último de estos cambios, de los cambios trascendentales, insisto, es en términos de comunicación. O sea, hemos comprendido y hemos asumido el tema de la comunicación como un elemento fundamental en un proyecto de humanidades digitales, y la comunicación transcurre a través de diferentes programas y plataformas, usando las redes sociales, usando los propios repositorios digitales y espacios buenos como estos, donde también la comunicación fluye de otra manera.
On communication, we can say that as a result of this project, the Proyecto Humboldt Digital, the Oficina has also improved the communication strategy of heritage through web platforms and social media.
Y bueno, quizás lo más relevante de todos estos cambios tiene que ver con esta diapositiva, donde tratamos de mostrar que el proyecto Humboldt Digital está llegando a su fin en este año, y que nosotros estamos actualmente en condiciones de iniciar nuevos proyectos de cooperación, humanidades digitales. Tenemos condiciones para hacerlo solo, y por eso hemos aprovechado toda la campaña de comunicación y toda la infraestructura de imagen del proyecto Humboldt Digital para usar el ProHD como proyecto futuro de humanidades digitales en la Oficina del Historiador.
Finally, in the last phase of the project of Humboldt Digital, we are preparing the conditions to continue having digital humanities projects with the same philosophy, and for that purpose we are using or reusing this identity that also means pro humanidades digitales, that is promoting humanidades digitales.
I will be very brief on this side due to our time. Basically, you can sum up the impact, I would say, that this project has had on the institution that I work in Berlin, that we implemented a couple of, let's say, elements of internationalization that were not part or are not usually part of our work. Obviously, Berlin is a very international city, and if you work in a Berlin-based university, you are in a very international environment. And also the Berlin-Brandenburg Academy has quite some international projects, but at the same time, it's still a very, very German organization. And so we tried to give some international impulses. One of the important aspects, I think, is the internationalization of the research software framework IDIARUM, which is the cornerstone of digital scholarly editing at our academy. So now everybody who works in Spain, in Spanish context, Spanish-speaking context, can also use Ediarum because we translated not only the software elements of it, but also the documentation behind it. These are pretty much the things we take away from this project. We try to think about what would we do or what would we focus on if we would do this all over again starting next year. And one of the things, most of these things to practitioners like you are probably pretty obvious, but at least for us, it's one of the learning lessons that we took. You always have to decide on some technology, on some platform, on some technical solution at some point, on some format at some point, but you always deal with a moving target. So it's a matter of staying concise and staying flexible at the same time, and this is really not an easy task. This also has to do, I think this is linked to the fact that we really need to document these processes, not for just for ourselves, but also for everybody else working in the field, especially in areas where there aren't that many DH projects yet, and where you still need like new ground truth, so to speak, for others to continue and to create stepping stones for other people. I will finish because we need to finish, and thank you very much for your attention.